Presbyterian Church. I'm Christopher Anderson, and I'm the current director of Children's Ministry and Youth Ministry here at CPC. Our Children's Ministry meets after our Sunday service at 12 p.m. over Zoom, and Youth Group meets for socially distant gatherings on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. We also have a college group that meets at church on Thursdays at 7 p.m. If you have a child or know someone who does, my email can be found in the announcements, so feel free to contact me and get connected. More importantly, we're so glad to be together today to worship with one another. As a reminder, please feel free to join in as much as you can in the service as a symbol of our unity. Pause, sing, and pray along with us on screen or wherever you may be.
Tuesday, so if you haven't heard, we are there. So tell us a little bit about that.
So yeah, we're pretty excited because we've been able to go over
and visit the house each night. And each night we stand out on our front porch area and the front yard area, and we greet neighbors who are walking by. And so we are already getting to know our neighbors and enjoying learning our community. And we cannot wait to host you as well.
And we'd like to give a shout out to the teachers and the students and those of you who are parents and now you're teachers as well. So we are praying for you.
Yes, I know. I stood there with Elizabeth, you know, trying to get all her technology up and running. And let me tell you, teachers, I know you feel like technology gurus at this point. And parents, you probably experienced the same anxiety I did trying to get Elizabeth settled.
So every week, we're going to continue to gather, to open the Word, to study, to pray, and we hope that you will continue to join us. And this morning, as we do our responsive reading, I'm going to read a part of what Scripture declares, and then together with Evie, you are going to declare the truth of what God says we are. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, I am not ruled by fear because the Holy Spirit lives in me and gives me his power, love, and self-control.
This is who I am in Christ.
Ephesians 1:4 and 1 Peter 1:16, teach us that I am holy without blame before him in love.
This is who I am in Christ.
Philippians 4:7 teaches us that I have peace of God that surpasses all understanding.
And this is who I am in Christ.
Colossians 3:9-10 teaches us that we are renewed in the knowledge of God and no longer want to live in our old ways or nature before we accepted Christ.
And this is who I am in Christ.
And finally, Colossians 3:9-10 teaches us that I am renewed in the knowledge of God and no longer want to live in my old ways or nature before I accepted Christ.
Amen, because this is who I am in Christ.
Let us pray. God, thank you for technical difficulties and for technical power to be able to connect with the whole world, with our congregation. So this morning, as we worship, as we pray, as we sing, we're asking that you would work in our hearts and show us, remind us who we are in Jesus Christ. And together we all said, amen. Amen.
Our sinful life flows before thee, O Joyful, joyful indeed. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord. My name is Matthew Jew. I am the elder for finance and administration here at CPC. Come join with me as we bow our heads in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful that you are a God who loves intimate relationships. You invite the little children into your laps, and you invite us now to come before you and to lay before us our cares and concerns. Lord, we've been dealing with this coronavirus for the past few months, and that's made an impression on our lives. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to continue to press on and to continue to look to you. And Lord, lately we've been dealing with these fires that are surrounding us, folks who have had their homes threatened or even have been burned down. We pray for those people. We pray also for our first responders, the firefighters, and those who are at this moment trying to protect their homes. Pray, Lord, that they would listen to your voice. If it's time to evacuate and leave, may they do so. And Lord, we pray for our churches to be ready to minister to the needs of those who will need your help in the future. Lord, we're just thankful that you invite us to come with our cares. And now, Lord, we as a church body want to lift up the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. So join with me in saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi there. For those of you who've joined a little late in Zooming, my name is Lori Howard, and we welcome you to Centerville Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are here. So aside from being part of the worship team, also was blessed to be a part of the pastoral nominating committee, and so I'm especially excited about letting you know about today's drive-through to welcome Pastor Sam and his family. And that is today. It's going to be behind the gym. So drive behind the gym and say hello and introduce yourself to Sam, Evie, and Elizabeth. That will be taking place from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock. Please wear your mask when you say hello and smile nicely underneath them. So the beautiful flowers that you see in front of us were donated today by two different families, Wayne and Sue Brask, in honor of Wayne's mother, Olga Gronley Brask, who would be 100 years old today, and also Sue's father, Merle, who would be 102. The other arrangement was given to us today by the Kuhn family in honor of, and I know it's going to be hard to believe that she's 85 today, but those of you who know Lucille Kuhn, make sure that you wish her a happy 85th birthday. And I wish her one as well because I love that lady. And they are to, in honor of, I'm going to read this now. They want to honor her as their wonderful mother and acknowledge their gratitude to God for blessing them with such an amazing, loving mom, sister, Grammy, aunt-in-law, and that she is a Christian role model. How blessed they are and how she and her family have blessed our congregation in this community over the years. So that's it. We will now listen to a lovely choral arrangement that's based on Psalm 8 called May the Words of My Mouth.
the thoughts of my heart. Bless your name, bless your name, Jesus. And the deeds of the day, and the truth in my way, speak of you, Jesus. For this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything and heaven follow you. I'll follow you. Lord, will you be my vision? Lord, will you be my guide? Be my hope, be my life and the way. Is on the earth, only you'll be the first on my heart. For this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. To do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything to heaven, follow you. I'll follow you. I'll follow.
Morning. My name is Sydney Belanger, and I am the elder for adult ministries here at CPC. Open your Bibles to Psalm 8. I will be reading that. Oh Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. You have taught children and infants to tell of your strength, silencing your enemies and all those who oppose you. When I look at the night sky and I see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them, human beings that you should care for them? Yet you made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority. The flock and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks for reading, Sydney. Let's join together in prayer. God, we just resonate with the words of Psalm 8 with David as you wrote. We are just so amazed at your bigness, at your glory, at the wonder of what you have made. And when we think about your power and your majesty, we're just humbled and awed that you would consider us, that you would grant us your favor, that you would place your image in us. And so this morning, Lord, as we open your word and we examine the principles and the word that you have spoken, God, help us to understand who we are in you, our family relationship. And God, then would you help us to be able to share this good news with others. In Jesus' name, we all said, amen. Well, I don't know if you've seen The Incredibles, but I've seen it about 963 times. If you haven't seen it, it's about a family of superheroes, and they do amazing things, and that's why they're called The Incredibles. So one day they're gathered around the dinner table arguing, as families do, and the boy, they're talking about their powers, and the boy says, "It's what defines me." And the father looks over and says, "What?" He says, "I don't know what that means. I saw it on TV." But I wonder, what is it in your life that defines you? What is your primary identity? We all have things that we look to that we think, this is who makes me who I am. But out of all the things that make you who you are, let me ask you, what is primary? There is a man named Nick Vujicic. Maybe you've heard of him. And as you look at the picture of Nick, you might think, oh, you know, it looks like a normal guy. But if you look a little bit closer, you'll notice that Nick has no arms and no legs. He was born in 1982 in Melbourne, Australia, and the sonograms failed to tell his parents what was coming. And so they were surprised, and the doctors had no explanation of what went wrong. But he began to press in, and his parents began to press in to figure out how to deal with these limitations. And the early days were difficult. Maybe you've had challenges in your life. Maybe something has come up in your life and that presented unexpected circumstances. But this, believe me, was so unexpected. And so Nick, as a child, began to wonder, why did this happen? How could God love me and allow something like this to happen? And he began to struggle with depression and loneliness. And he even began to have questions and thoughts about taking his own life. But I want to tell you that God began to use the life of Nick when he understood who he really was. And today I want to talk about who is it that God made us to be? What is our primary identity? Because for us and so many people in the world, we have a mistaken sense of identity, and we have forgotten the purpose and the plan that God has put into each one of us. And so we're going to take a look at John chapter 1 and look at what our primary identity is, and it starts with Jesus. John 1, beginning with verse 9, says, "The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world," that's Jesus, "and the world was made through him." Now watch this. The world was made through him. That means he's the creator. But then it says the world did not recognize him, and he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Verse 12, "Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor of a husband's will, but born of God." We're going to take a look at this passage. We're going to break it up. But we want to understand how we find our primary identity. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. What does this say? The world did not recognize him. Has there ever been a time in your life that you did not gain the recognition that you were looking for? Verse 11, "He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him." And what the book of Hebrews says is Jesus knows our every struggle. Jesus knows what it's like to be human, to go through struggles like you have gone through. And maybe you have looked in the mirror and you've thought, "I feel rejected." Maybe the label that you carry is a label of betrayal, and you feel like what identifies you is being betrayed. Someone close to you has sold you down the river. Maybe you feel like you don't matter. Maybe when you think about your life or someone that you know, they just have this deep sense of nothing that I do matters. Maybe you hold a sign. It says, "My life just doesn't work." Do you know someone who feels that way? Maybe you hold a sign that says, regrets only. I don't have a hope or a future. Maybe the sign that you have says addict, and you feel enslaved to substances or practices that control your life. Maybe you're just anxious, and just going into the day is really hard to handle. And COVID-19 has not made it any easier. This whole environment that we are in right now is just a perfect environment to develop anxiety. Maybe your label says weak. Maybe that's how you feel about yourself. Maybe because of that, you hold a feeling that you are a victim because of something that you've experienced. Maybe you're just angry because of something that's happened to you. But I want to talk to you this morning about where our identity comes from and this idea that identity must be received, not achieved. Identity must be received, not achieved. So let me, I love what Tim Keller has to say about this. He asks the question, what is identity? It's a sense of self and a sense of worth. What makes you feel significant? What makes you confident of your value? If you have a sense of value, a sense of worth, we say that you have a strong identity. But listen, it's an illusion to say, my identity comes from my inner feelings. People say all the time, well, this is who I am. You decide who you are. That's what people think. And we see this all around us. We've experienced it ourselves. But how many people do you know who, when their main source of identity failed, their performance, their job, a relationship, their likes or their shares, their financial accounts crashed, when all those things crashed, one of those main things that you were relying on or someone you know was relying on, when those things crashed, they crashed. You crashed. When you make anything your identity, when you make your career your identity, or your a particular body your identity, or a particular love relationship your identity, those things stop being good things, and they start to crush you. C.S. Lewis, in his book, Mere Christianity, said, we say that people are proud of being rich or clever or good-looking, but they are not. They are proud of being richer or cleverer or better-looking than others. If everyone else became equally rich or clever or good-looking, there would be nothing to be proud about, right? Another way of saying this is pride gets no pleasure out of having something, only out of having more of it than the next person. You following me? So you may be the smartest student at Mission High School or wherever you go, but then you arrive on the college campus and you're just one of a class full of 4.0s. And you realize that you're just a small fish in a big pond, and you feel like you just lost your identity. Maybe you're the best violinist in your class, but you get on the BART and you go downtown San Francisco, and a homeless person begging for money is playing better than you. Listen, any identity that is achieved rather than received has to be excluding. In other words, you feel better because other people are not as good as you, whatever the field. These other people are not as enlightened as you. These other people are not as liberal as you. These other people are not as conservative as you. These other people are not as hardworking as you. They're not as insightful as you. This is how many people feel good about themselves, by looking at other people and trashing them. So let me ask you, what kind of identity do we need? Here's what we need. You can't take self and bless yourself and name yourself. You need recognition. You need somebody outside to come in and speak into your life. We're social and relational beings. We're compelled to do that. Now, even when I say that. Some people will say, you know, I'm going online, and then they write, you know, I've done this and that, and my family has rejected me. But I know who I am, and this is who I am. And suddenly thousands of people on social media are there, and they just got the approval that they were seeking as they put these words out there. But watch this. They didn't just say, I've just decided who I want to be. No. No, what they've done is they have a new set of cheerleaders, and they got rid of the old set of cheerleaders. But they still had people on the outside speaking in to their lives. You have to have a word from the outside. You have to have someone else to name you. So let me ask you, what kind of person should this be? What kind of people should this be? You need the love and approval and the esteem of someone to esteem you if you're going to have this self-esteem. And this person, whoever it is, should not be someone who's going to let you down. This should not be someone who's going to disillusion you. If you get your self-worth from the fill in the blank, what's your blank? What gives you a sense of value? What gives you a sense of worth? Academics, sports. What happens when those people, the things disillusion you, which they might? Where does your self-worth go? This also can't be a person who's fickle. Someone who's up and down with you, depending on how well you perform. Do you have people like that in your life? You get praised when you do well, and boy, you get criticized when you don't. Think about this. If it's really true that the praise of the praiseworthy is above all rewards, but only if you have the esteem of someone you esteem. We have self-esteem only if we have the adoration of someone who adores you. Now watch this. Think about this. Then to know that God loves you, the one who made you, the Lord of the universe, that he loves you, that would have to give you the most powerful basis for stable identity possible. And secondly, it isn't based on your performance. Because it's not based on your performance, it's not only stable, but you don't need to look down your nose at everyone else. In other words, the excluding aspect of your identity goes away. So how do you get that? John chapter 1, verse 12. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. Now watch this. Becoming children of God. What happened when we became children of God, when we believed on him and we received this new identity, that we trusted Christ to take away our sin and give us a new relationship with God? This is what Christians believe happened when we believe in Christ and his death on the cross. We receive the right to become children of God. In ancient culture, sons were named as legal heirs. Now, in the original language, this children of God, in some translations, it's called sons. And some people thought, oh, we need to make this kind of just gender friendly. Okay, so, and it does give the idea of children. But when you look at traditional cultures all around the world, who gets the inheritance? It's the sons. And so even my father, who was born in 1925, he got a double blessing. His inheritance would have been his father's farm and his uncle's farm. He got it all. Many of the countries that you come from, it's still that way today. The man, the son, gets everything. And when Paul is writing in Scripture saying that we have the rights of sons, he's saying, whether you're man or woman, you get all of the rights and privileges and the benefits of everything God has for you. God stepped in and radically declared that men and women are co-heirs together. And therefore, as children of God, we get to inherit the heavenly blessings and identity of who God says we are. Yet to all who receive him, this is the call, this is the invitation, this is what God is speaking to you. If you don't know God, God says, you know what? I died for you. Jesus died for your sins. To those who receive him, to those who believe in his name, there is a name, Jesus. He is the God of God and the King of Kings, and he wants to save you. He wants to rescue you, and he wants to place his identity in you because it's already there because you were created in the image of God. What happened when he did that? He gave the right to you, to me, to those who believe, to become children of God. And I love this. Watch this. Children not born of natural descent nor of human decision. This is a contrast because if you go anywhere in the world in traditional culture, where do you get your identity? Your family, right? You are known and defined by who your family is or by who your family says you are. And so this is oftentimes an Eastern way of thinking. And in the West, oftentimes we're very individualistic. And we think, I make my own decisions. I decide my own life. It doesn't matter what my parents say. It doesn't matter what my community says. I make up my own life. And watch what John says. And I don't know what his intents when he wrote this, but this is amazing what the Spirit did when he spoke through John. It said, it doesn't matter whether you get your identity from your family, your community of natural descent of your family, or you get your identity or worth based on who you say you are. I'm going to tell you who you are because I made you. And I love you. And when you're born, watch this. When you're born into what? You're born into a family. And this family does give you your identity, the family of God, the perfect father. No matter what you've experienced from your dad, from your father, the heavenly father is a perfect father. And he says, when you're born into his family, it doesn't matter where you think you're getting your identity, from your human family or your own decisions. Your heavenly father said, I put my image in you to give you a whole new way of living. Yet to all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. And that's the invitation today. If you don't know God and you've been wondering, you've been thinking, this is really interesting to me. I need someone who's bigger than me, my creator, to identify me, to give me my life and to give me my purpose. Then as we lean into that, we understand that we're not defined by the labels that we might wear, but by who God says we are. Let's go back to Nick Wojcik. This is Nick now. He experienced a miracle. Not only does he have an amazing wife and four children with no arms and no legs, but when he understood who he was, he had new purpose in life. And this man with no arms and no legs began to travel the world and to tell people who were fully bodily equipped, who were struggling with depression, who were struggling with anger and rejection and addiction, that there's more than that that defines you. And he has been, more than 1 million people under the sound of his voice have said, because I see what is true in his life, I want Jesus. And in the next 10 years, his goal is to reach 1 billion people as he travels the world to be able to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And so I want to encourage you, as you think about the label that you wear, how about this one? What if your core identity, your prime identity as a child of God was beloved? There's no fear of rejection in the Lord. The Bible says that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And when God takes your sin, he throws it in the deepest sea and he separates it as far as the east is from the west and he puts up a no fishing sign. There is no bringing back what God has put aside. And now, because you are beloved, you are free to share this overwhelming love of God with the people in your life. the people that you come in contact with. You are beloved. So this is your new identity. You're adopted according to the Bible into God's family. That's a new identity, right? You're a citizen of heaven. That's a new identity, right? You're united to Christ. That's a new identity, right? But watch this. Jesus didn't just show up and simply name you and say, you're mine. He died for our sins, our failures, our missing the mark, and then he rose from the dead. Dear ones, listen, this is an identity that is stable. You can know who you are. You can have an identity that's not achieved, that's not crushing, but that's received. How do you do that? You believe that he died for you, and then you take that label, that identity that he says you and I are as we believe in him. And I just want to close today, as we've been doing at the services, and we're going to say that this candle is going to be lit because there are people in this congregation, whether they be mission partners or people within the church or partner ministries, who are sharing the good news of Jesus, and people are celebrating new birth and their new identity in Christ. Listen what Pastor Custer Lowe said, and he wrote us an email this week when we talked about celebrating the good things God's doing. He said, the place to be is in the middle of an Indian reservation where God is really working among the people. Pastoring on the Navajo reservation, I've seen God do wonders in the lives of people, and I've come in contact with people under trying times. COVID-19 and through a hard, it was a hardship for many, and it also worked on behalf of the Lord and Savior as he brought people into relationship with him. People who never walked with God loved ones died from COVID-19. Or from people who recovered from it. So far, God has brought into his fold 12 in this community that I pastor. So God, we want to say thank you for the 12 that have experienced new life. People who have suffered from COVID-19. People who have recovered from COVID-19. That you are still in the midst of hardship in this life. And that you grant us our identity. God, thank you for this time together as we worship you. In Jesus' name, we all said, amen.
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen? That all the dark won't stop the light from getting through.
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning? Creation coming, and is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the sea and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David the truth and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory?
Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain from every people and tribe, every nation and tongue. He has made us a kingdom and a priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is. He is. Is he worthy?
Of all our praise and honor and glory. We thank you, Jesus, for who you are and what you did. We thank you for bringing us Pastor Sam, Evie, and Elizabeth. God bless you all, and God bless you, Sam.
Thank you. Hey, thank you, worship team. And I love that song because it reminds us of the power behind us being beloved, because when we see God for all he is, in all of his glory, is he worthy? When we see the majesty of who he is, then it makes it even more amazing that he chose us, that he loves us. He is worthy of all our praise and our glory and our honor that we can give to him. So as we close out today, would you put your hands up and receive the blessing of the Lord? God, we ask that you would help us to understand that through faith we can receive you. God, that we would continue to believe in you just as we did at first. And for those among us who do not yet believe, that today would be the day that they would believe. And God, that we all together who believe in you would live as children of God, confident in their identity in you, receiving and living in the rights of children of God. And in all God's children said, amen.